everybody. Assalamu alaikum, Sastikal, Namaskar to all the listeners. This is Atyadi Shah Peerally for the Shah Peerally Law Show. And today we are November 8th, 2018. The year is almost gone. And we are live. And of course I have Michael on the board with me. I hope you can hear me well, Michael. Please just let me know. And of course, anything I'm going to tell you today is my opinion. You should not act or refrain to act solely on the information provided. You should contact an attorney for any questions. First of all, happy Diwali to all the listeners, and also belated, of course, because the show is today. And also, so many things happen. Mostly, if you look at the political side, we had the elections, and congrats to the Democrats for taking back the House, which I'm pretty sure is going to have now an impact on immigration. Hopefully it will be a good impact. Let's see how things are going to unfold. But having said that, it's still not the battle. It's just one battle won. There are a lot more battles coming, and there are a lot of course, probably bad news coming, but we are hoping some good news will come in. One of the other things that happened also, Attorney General Jeff Sessions resigned. Well, he was forced to resign. And as you know, he was very much not really pro-immigration either. But who's going to replace him? I think Whitaker is going to replace him. I don't know him actually, so I cannot really know what are his intentions on immigration. So let us see what will happen next. There are already talks that there will be a review by the Democrats of all the immigration rules. In the meantime, it seems like Trump is planning to pass some kind of rules, kind of changing how asylum is obtained. Like, for example, someone entered unlawfully across the border, they might not be able to file for asylum, and that's what they're planning to pass. It's not law yet, but these are all coming up here. And also, a lot of people, of course, are having issues with what we call their H-1Bs, especially those who are CAP. So we're going to talk a little bit about all this, but first, I think, Michael, we have some callers, right? So this is Shah Peerally, 11 here. Hello. Yes.
Yeah,
hello.
Hi. Yeah, good morning. Hi.
Good morning. How are you, sir?
Yeah. So last month I applied for H1, H4, H4AD extension. Like last month I was in consulting, so I got a full-time opportunity and applied H1, H4, H4AD. And simultaneously I applied H1 extension with my previous employer and H4 and H4AD. So my H1 extension, H4 and H4AD got approved, and I moved to the new client, end client. And my employer has withdrawn my H1 extension 2 weeks, I think 1 to 2 weeks back. And a couple of days back, I received a notice from USCIS that my wife's F1 to H4 immigration status is actually denied, as my I-129 has been withdrawn or denied. So I wanted to ask, would that be any impact? Because it got approved last month, and this month the old application got denied.
Okay, let me get it right. So you have two companies. You transfer to company B, where you file an H1, and you also file an H4 and H4EAD on the transfer. In the meantime, company A went ahead and also filed for an extension of H1B, H4, H4ED, right?
Correct.
Okay. And now you got a denial for which one? The first one or the second one?
The second one. First one got approved, second one got denied.
Okay. You mean the one from company A got denied, right?
Yeah, company A, let's say company A is my old company where I was working, and company B is my...
That's the one that got denied, right?
Yeah, company B got approved, their new client, and company A got denied.
Okay. Well, technically it should not affect you because you already moved to company B, And the extension is included in the transfer. Plus, since your wife's case is attached, the H4 is attached to this new company. If you had the H4 for ED, you should not be worried.
Okay.
Because, of course, the first one is withdrawn, so it will be denied. Okay?
Okay, right. So as long as it doesn't matter if the latest one is denied, right? As long as the company B is approved and...
because you're working with company B, so everything is attached to company B. What happened when they withdraw for A, of course, your wife's H4 also got withdrawn. But the fact that it was filed on time and you already got it approved and you moved to B, there's no problem.
Okay, all right. Thank you. I have one other
good luck. Yeah, I have to take someone else. I can't take that one. So, but go ahead and give me a call at the office if you want to do a consultation. 510-742-5887. Let me take another caller, Michael. This is where you 11. Hello?
Hello?
Yes. Hello. Hi.
Hello. Hi. How are you?
I'm doing okay. What can I say here?
Yeah, my name is Anjana. So I have a few questions on my travel to India. So if you have a time, I'll just briefly describe my
We cannot do it long. You can ask your question quickly because I have other people waiting.
Yeah.
So go ahead and tell me if you can get that done in one minute or so, then I can answer. Go ahead.
So, recently my H1 got approved and I'm planning to go to stamping. So, I just want to ask you that is it better to get it stamped in India or Canada?
There are advantages on both. Canada is closer, it's cheaper, and sometimes the waiting time is far, is not as long. But going back to India also has its advantage. For example, let's say your case is stuck on 1G or something, then it is better to stay in a country where you can stay without any kind of cost. And also, you don't need any visa for India because this is your country. So each one has its own advantage or disadvantage. If your case is clear-cut, no problem, then you can go to Canada because it's probably cheaper just to buy a ticket and go there. I don't know how much the ticket is.
No. Actually, I was planning to go to India because it's been 7 years and I never been to India. And my case was really complicated. So I was in S2 then converted to S1. And then I was in OPT for 3 years and then I'm on CPT. So after 6 years, I got my H1, so it's a bit complicated. So I'm not sure how to proceed with my stamping.
Well, in this case, it's better to go to India because if the case gets delayed, at least you are safe in India. Now, the question is, did you get a change of status or is the council processing? That's why you have to go out.
No, it's change of status, so there's no need for me to go out.
So why are you going for stamping? Because you have to travel?
Yeah, I want to visit India because it's been 7 years. I wanted to go there.
When did you get your H-1B?
October 17th, it got approved.
Okay. I would recommend to work a few months before you take off. Go for your stamping. It's better, then you have few check stuff, etc. It will make your case easier when you go for the interview. You can show it's a genuine job offer, etc. Now, if you really want to go, you can still go, but you're saying you have a complicated situation with CPT and everything, so be ready that they will ask those questions because they have been really targeting people on CPT. So, I recommend that to you. You make sure you have all your paperwork right.
And then my last question is this, do you want me to continue my studies and finish my degree or can I discontinue now? Because they might ask me why I discontinued my CPT.
Okay, hold on a second. As soon as your H-1B got approved as a change of status, your student visa is gone.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. As for the CPT, there are many other issues. It's very hard to tell. It's best you give us a call. I can do a full consultation. Then I can tell you how or where you stand. call the office, they will schedule a consultation, 510-742-5887, because it might be a long kind of assessment if we have to look into the CPT, etc., etc. But be careful, I would not recommend you travel without talking to your sister. Okay. Let me take another call on my
phone.
Hello? I can't hear you. Sorry. Hello. This is Shah Peerally 11 here. Hello? Okay. I think I lost the caller, so I apologize, ladies and gentlemen. Just to let people know, you know, if you want to call, 510-657-1170. 510-657-1170. This is the number to the studio. Now, if you want a full consultation, just to let you know, anything I tell you usually on the radio is purely educational. It's not meant for being an advice, because I have limited time and I have limited information to really give you a conclusion. All I can do is pretty much kind of do a general assessment and guide you in general. So be careful, because if I don't have all the facts, I might tell you one thing and it doesn't work, so I don't want you to get penalized for it. So be careful. If you have other details on your case you want to discuss, it's better to do it in private, to a private consultation at our office, 510-742-5887. Now, if you have general questions, even a little bit with personal data, I can still handle that for you, as long as you know there are no issues of time. So feel free to call the radio, 510-657-1170, 510-657-1170. Now, we were talking about the elections. Amazingly, we are seeing a lot of things going to happen now from there. Let's see, once the Democrat takes the House in January, how things are going to unfold. But let me take another call and we'll talk a little bit about issues in immigration. This is Shah Peerally, 11 here. Hello? Hello, this is Shah Peerally.
Good morning, Ali. This
morning,
is Ishwar. I have one question for you, actually. So, actually, it's regarding the form. My employer actually filed my form in the May 2018, and in the September month 2018, I have one audit, and it was responded on October 1st of week. I would like to know about the duration of the process to get completed my form process. So could you please help me on this?
Sure. Well, helping you, there's not much we can do in terms of lawyers. You just have to wait. But it's taking, the audit can take up to from 6 months to sometimes 1.5 years. So you need to be patient, unfortunately.
Okay. Actually, my auditor, it's a regular audit process which doesn't call them for the category of a long duration. So, but I just like to understand. So usually in the forums also I could find the same statement what you mentioned. It would be in the span of 6 months to 1.5 years. So would there be any separation between this categorization, Ali?
Categorization?
Initially, after 3 months actually, I got this one, and does it consider my case duration from the day one they filed the duration, or the duration what you are mentioning about is going to start from the day the audit was responded?
It starts from the day you answered the audit.
Okay. Thank you so much.
But the timing is I might be wrong, because the timing, I had one case where the audit got cleared in 4 months. So it's a case-by-case basis. But the average is between 3 months up to sometimes 15 months. Okay?
Okay. Thank you so much, Sean. Yeah.
Good luck to you. Let me take a call. This is Shah Peerally, 11 here. Hello? Hello? Hello, I think I lost the caller, Michael. So, ladies and gentlemen, please feel free to call 510-657-1170. I was just checking if I got the number right. So, let's just talk a little bit about, the new rules and all that new rules, but the change of political dynamic, will that affect immigration? We're hoping in a good way, yes, because there might be legislations that are pushed by Congress to protect immigrants. Having said that, it will still have to go to the Senate, etc., etc. So we need to not rejoice ourselves until we see exactly where things are going. So I think I have one caller, right, Michael? This is Shah Peerally Esq. Hello.
So I got a situation with two companies here, and I'm about to join a company. So my question is, can I take at least like 2 weeks off paycheck from the both the company, because the company B I'm joining on the visit. So is it okay to get the paycheck from the both the company for at least 2 weeks on S&B?
Well, usually yes, because both of them kind of run concurrently as long as it's not canceled. But yeah, because at the end of the day, it's not like you didn't have a valid status with both of them.
So no, I said the valid status with company A, but company B, I'm joining on the receipt. So they have filed the H-1B, but I'll be joining company B on the receipt. So my question is, can I take the paycheck for at least 2 weeks or one month from both of them at the same time?
Well, I understand that you want to. Yeah, there's no problem, because you have, it's kind of running concurrently at this point. So okay. Since you need to at least have checks up from one, having two is not a problem. Although you don't want to kind of having to give explanation later, but it should not affect your status. Okay, if that's your question.
Yeah, because I heard that, you know, naturally you can work for at least one employer at a time.
Yeah. Yeah, this is called multiple H-1Bs, concurrent H-1Bs. That's what I was saying. Okay,
so I have to file with company B the concurrent H-1B, not the new H-1B, right? H-1 transfer.
You don't have to really file as concurrent.
Okay.
You can just file as regular. And
okay.
Then if there is any questions, you can explain that. Okay?
Okay. Yeah. Thanks, man.
Okay. Good luck to you. I think I have one more caller, right, Michael? This is Shah Peerally Esq. Yeah, that's the caller. So feel free to call, ladies and gentlemen, 510-657-1170. And, of course, we are talking about immigration law, which is a hot topic. And then, and what happened now that the Democrat took over the House, still the Senate in the hands of the GOP. So we need to see actually how things are going to unfold in America in terms of people's immigration. But there was also another news, Jeff Sessions, who is was our Attorney General, but at the same time was very kind of quote unquote anti-immigration, got hired today. So a lot of people might be happy, but at the same time some are worried about it. Who's next? So all those are going to factor in actually in the next few months for our immigration cases. So watch out for new legislation, some protection hopefully from Democrats, etc., etc. Let's wait and see. But congrats to the Democrats. They made it back. Hopefully now there will be some good stuff happening. And also, just to let you know, all the stuff I'm discussing about is pretty much my opinion, and the radio has nothing to do with it. So, another thing, I think we have another caller, right, Michael? This is Shah Peerally Esq. Hello?
Hello?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, I'm listening to you.
Yes, Mr. Ali, I have a question. I have an uncle who is visiting from India, and his visa was the permission to grant was already expired, so he asked for an extension, and he asked for an extension till November 20th. And there have been no reply from the authorities. And I'm wondering, and he wants to stay a little longer, so what's the best way? Should he just write a letter saying that he wants to extend now till January, or does he have to file the extension form and pay the fee?
Did he come in a visitor visa, or visa he came in?
Visitor visa.
Okay. And then right now he filed for an extension. When did you say he filed for the extension?
He filed about 3 months ago, and there has been no reply yet. And but he asked for like
it's kind of normal timing. But this is the thing: if the case gets approved, everything is perfect. But if the case gets denied, it reverts back to the date when the I-94 got expired. So you need to be careful on that.
Right. So this is why, I mean, he wants to stay a little longer. So what's the best way? Should he apply for extension, additional extension till January? Or can he just write a simple letter saying that I had applied for extension and I had not been approved or, you know, not been denied either, but I would like to extend that till January? What's your recommendation?
Well, he can just go and ask for another extension right now is pending. You have to wait and see. If it gets denied, then it becomes tricky because number one, what will happen is once you get denied, that time on the I-94 start counting for unlawful presence. And then what it does, they also cancel, sometimes they cancel the stamp on the passport. So that's the risk of doing extension. As for if 3 months have passed, another thing I can tell you also, since they're giving extension mostly for 3 months now, they will probably not give another one. What you can do, unfortunately, there's no way to know. So you cannot do anything right now except to wait, usually.
Okay.
Mm. So if the case is pending,
the deadline is coming. I don't expect any reply from them because since they haven't replied, it's unlikely that I'll get a reply, in another week or so.
Okay, and you, and he's still here?
Yeah, he's still here. He originally asked for extension till like November 20th.
Okay. So. Pretty much, yeah. If he asks only that, I would recommend he leaves before he gets an answer. Because if the answer, even the answer is positive, you might get it to end at November 15th, for example, and it will create issues from there. So the best is to have him ready to leave in a few days, in a few weeks.
Even though he wants to extend his stay, and you won't recommend that.
He cannot extend right now because he doesn't have anything. He's in what we call a period of authorized stay, and once you are in that situation, you cannot really piggy ride and file another one. You can give it a shot, but. It is not logically possible because you don't know how many months they're going to give.
Okay.
So it is, there's all nothing right. You can really do right now except wait, okay?
All
and then
right,
if you get an approval, then you can file another extension.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Okay.
But if there's no reply, then what?
Well, there's no reply. As long as it's pending, he's in a period of authorized stay. That means he's allowed to stay when he's not in status.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Good luck to you. So let me take... Okay. I don't think I have more callers right, Michael. So I apologize, ladies and gentlemen. Sometimes, you know, when calculating cases, it is very important to strategize them properly. And sometimes I have to think, especially with the climate going on right now, sometimes you do something that you were doing in the past, now things have changed, etc. So feel free to reach out, ladies and gentlemen, if you have any questions on immigration, 510-742-5887, and the website to check is attorneyandair.com. And also the radio, the studio line today is 510-657-1170, 510-657-1170. If you have any questions on immigration, you name it, H-1B, L-1, family petition, asylum, etc. We're here. If I can answer you, I'll try my best to do that. So talking about all the things are happening right now in terms of the politics, it seems like the house now is taken, has been taken by the Democrats, which has a clear majority. So will they be able to influence the decision of Trump? I don't know, honestly, because many of the things Trump is doing is pretty much kind of independent. So bottom line, at least it's something that gives us some hope. Many of the good laws are going to pass. So hang in there if you're kind of getting desperate, unless you want to move to Canada or something and then come back when things get better, you can do that too. Let me take another caller, Michael. Chopra, you're live in here.
Hi, Mr. Shah. Thanks for taking my call. I have a question about applying for parent green card, sponsoring green card for parents. So, but the situation is my mother-in-law, I-94 expires at the end of November. She came in May, so it expires at the end of November. We had applied for an extension of stay in September. It's still pending.
Mm-hmm.
My wife became a citizen recently, so she wants to sponsor for her mom, green card for her mom.
Mm-hmm.
So if we apply for green card now, will there be any impact because there is already extension of stay that's still pending?
Not really, because the intent at the origin was not. In fact, filing for her green card now is the best timing, because if she leaves, she comes back and file, it will be more difficult. It should not be an issue to file for her. And you can actually explain if they ask, okay, why was she here? And that she was visiting. That's it. And then, because that's... Why did she come, by the way? To visit her daughter, right?
Yeah, she came with the visa.
Okay, so if she came on a visitor visa, then she can explain she's visiting. So you don't have to get the extension. But this is the problem. Right now, the I-94 is already expired, right?
No, it's valid right till the end of November.
Okay, so make sure you file the case for her before end of November, and you don't have to file a new extension. Once it's filed, the adjustment of status is filed because your wife is a U.S. citizen, she goes into a period of authorized stay under INA 245A, which basically makes her legal to stay in the country. And actually, you can apply also for a work permit for her, and you can use that work permit as a proof that she has a pending adjustment of status. So
okay.
I will recommend quickly to file directly the green card, no need to file for the extension.
Okay, so the thing is, we have already applied for extension of stay, it's still pending. So if they deny the extension of stay, will it affect the green card application?
No, not usually, unless there's some kind of fraud.
Okay, we are planning on applying for the advanced parole.
Yes.
Do you know how long
it's taking? Advanced parole EAD also.
Yeah, advanced parole and EAD. But how long is it taking for them to issue advanced parole? Do you know?
Well, they can still come in a combo card. It takes like 90 days to 120 days.
Okay. Alright, I'll apply for that. Thank you.
Okay, good luck to you. If you need help, 1-0-7-4-2-5-8-8-7. I think Michael is telling me no more callers, so feel free to reach out 510-657-1170. And if you need help on any immigration matter, feel free to contact our office to help you. So again, Michael, I don't know if I have more callers. 510-657-1170. 510-657-1170. This is basically the attorney Shah Peerally talking about immigration law. And also we are covering the topic of the elections. And one of the things is now that is kind of obvious is that many people thought, because of the immigration instance of Trump and the GOP, they would have done better. But in fact, it didn't. It kind of backfired. So now we are hoping that we're going to see some good stuff coming from the Congress. Having said that, in all my career, I have not really seen anything good coming from the Congress. But this time, it seems like we have some really progressive. Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, hi Shah.
Yes, this is Shah, you're Lavanya, go ahead.
Shah, do you help in getting Canadian PR also?
I don't, but I can recommend you someone who can do it, because I'm not licensed in Canada. But I can, if you send me an email, shah@peerallylaw.com, shah@peerallylaw, you can have it on my website. I can introduce you to an attorney in Canada, okay?
So are they based out of Canada or US attorney?
Yeah, they are in Canadian. They are Canadian lawyers, just like us.
Okay.
They are not consultants or anything, they are licensed solicitors, okay?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Good luck to you.
Thanks.
So, well, this is a question a lot of people asking me too because of the difficulties that are having. They're trying to move to Canada or other countries. This is Shah Peerally, you're live in here. Hello? Hello?
Hey, morning, Shah.
Yes, sir. Morning. How are you?
I'm doing great. So, I have a couple of questions. I'll be quick and I'll take the answers offline.
Sure.
One is, my priority date is 2012, so I'm like asking you to look into crystal ball and tell me what do you think, what would be the progress on EB2, India? And another question is, I've seen EB3 dates of India catching up very fast with EB2.
Mm-hmm.
Say, hypothetically, if EB3 goes ahead of EB2, is it allowed or is it okay? And is it allowed to move from EB2 to EB3? Can it be done?
Yeah.
Those are my two questions. I'll take the answers offline. Thanks a lot. Thanks for it.
Well, very good question. Well, as for the crystal ball, unfortunately, I am not. The truth is that I don't have a ball. I kind of do a mathematical calculation and I look at things, how they progress and the timing. So at this point in time, in 2012, I think it's going to take at least 4 or 5 years. That's my prognostic. But EB3 might take less. And he, to answer your second question, the first, EB3 is basically going to go faster in the next 5-6 years. That's what most of us are thinking. Having said that, you can also shift it, I think if I'm not mistaken, to EB3. If the I-140 is already, before the I-140 gets approved, then it's easy because then when you file it directly EB3. But if the I-140 is already getting approved, then to move back to EB3, you might have to amend the I-140. Once it's amended, then you can merge it to EB3. I know some people from China, Chinese dissidents who have been able to do that, but I have not personally done one to kind of tell you for sure if it works or not. Okay, so let me take another caller. This is Shah Peerally, you live in here? Hello? Okay, I think I don't have any callers right now. So, ladies and gentlemen, again, we were talking about what's going on out there, especially the election time. Well, not election time, election is done, but what happened next is kind of surprising. For one, we have seen some really amazing candidates winning, especially the youngest. We had the youngest, we kind of break all the record this year on the midterm elections. Number one, we had the youngest congresswoman who got elected. Second, we got a Muslim congresswoman wearing the hijab from Somalia. Third, we got someone, a gay congressman. And also American natives. First, I think in history since 1789, we had American natives in Congress. This shows that really when people want to go and make a change, they can do it. So next time, the next elections, we should also make the change again. Let me take another call. This is Shah Peerally. Hello?
Hi, Shah Peerally. I have a question, something related to H4EAD. This year I have been on my F1 status and recently converted to H4EAD. Currently I'm carrying, so I will be taking a maternity leave. So would I be, I would be eligible for the maternity leave on the H4 EAD as well, right? Like,
well, are you asking immigration side? Immigration side doesn't make any difference because you're an H4. So you can work when you want to, you cannot work if you don't want to. As for the maternity leave, it's more like an employment law issue, so you might want to check with the employment law lawyer. But I don't see any reason why you should not get it.
Okay, so I mean, so there will be a California benefit, like in the state benefit for the maternity leave, right? So can I use that benefit under H4 EAD? And also recently I heard from the Trump administrator saying that people who use public benefit would not be eligible for the green card. Does this maternity benefit come under it or?
No. Maternity benefits come under insurance. Not the one that they are talking about. What she's talking about is welfare. It's about a bunch of stuff like medical, etc., etc. But no, it should not affect your case.
Okay. So maternity benefit doesn't come under that, right?
Yeah, it doesn't because. It's covered by the insurance that you pay. Okay.
Okay. Sure.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Let me take another call. This is Shah Peerally. You're live in here. Hello.
Hey, hi, Shah. This is Shailesh. Thanks for taking my call.
You're welcome.
So, Shah, I have a quick question. So, I have my case running with your group for EB1 processing. And I just want to know, when EB1 case is filed under premium, how long does it take for USCIS to acknowledge that they have received the case, and when actually the time period starts for premium processing? I'll take that answer offline.
Okay, that's a very good question. Well, technically, it's case by case, depending on their load of work. It doesn't take that long, but we have seen cases where sometimes the receipts come like 3 weeks later, which is not right because it was premium, but we don't really argue with them because the answer in this specific case I'm mentioning came like 4 or 5 days after we got the receipt, we got an approval. So usually you will get a receipt within the first few days, depending on the case, within the next 10 days you should get a receipt. And once from there, you start counting the days in 2 weeks. So, but by the way, thank you so much for being with us on the EB1. And I wanted to congratulate the team of DC that just got 2 EB1A approved yesterday in a shot. So congrats. We are doing a lot of them. And for those who don't know what's an EB1A, it's an amazing thing. If, number one, you don't need an employer to get the green card. Number two, EB1A, I'm sorry for that. So EB1A is very interesting because the checklist that you've seen before is not really the checklist we use, and we're still getting a lot of EB1. So I don't know if I can take more callers right now, Michael. If you have one, I'll take one last one after that. I'll be talking a little bit about debt settlement because this is our next topic. Debt settlement is one of the places where we help people. If you have credit card debt, some people have second mortgage and some remorses that are the water, we can help you. Aside from immigration, it's a separate department, and we can help you get rid of those debts. Feel free to reach out to us, 510-742-5887. I think we have one caller, right, Michael? This is Shah Peerally, 11 here.
Hey, Shah, this is Amit.
Hey, Amit. Okay, so you're the Amit, give me 2 minutes and then I'll wrap up and then you can take over. So wrap up today to talk about the elections. Congrats to the Democrats. We're taking back the House. So hopefully we're going to see some good stuff coming up. I hope. And then the new team that the thing that is interesting with this election, it's never been an important election in midterm, but this time it was important because of all the things going on. It kind of shifted a little, not shifted the balance of power, but actually reduced that full control on the three, three ventures, even four, I could call it. So it is an interesting and historic moment because people who got elected were really unique people. So let's see how this affects immigration. And again, if you need help with immigration, 510-742-5887. If you need help on debt settlement, same number, 510-742-5887. And anything I told you today is my opinion. You should not act or refrain to act solely on the information provided. You should contact an attorney if you have any questions. And Amit, you're there?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah. Hi, Amit. I think you have 11 to 12 minutes to go. I'll let you finish because I'm a little bit tired today. So I have kind of finished some work. So I'll let you guys finish and you can explain a little bit about debt settlement.